Hi, you're watching Managing Money with Money Control. I'm Sakshi Batra. We're in the new financial year and it's definitely a great time to plan your finances and investments. Let's talk about investments first. If you invest in mutual funds or want to do so, I have some good news for you. Starting 1st of April, mutual funds have become cheaper. Also, your debt funds are more transparent than ever before. Our personal finance expert, Kayezad Adajania, joins in to share more details on the same. Thanks a lot, Kayezad. Great to have you on the show. Now tell us, how have mutual funds become cheaper with the start of this new financial year?
Hi, Sakshi. Great to be back again. Thank you. Now to answer your question, what happens is that every time you invest in a mutual fund, remember that there are costs that the mutual fund incurs to run and manage your money and to run the fund house. Now, these costs are basically fund manager salaries, operating cost, auditor fees, R&T fees, distribution commission, and so on and so forth. All these costs come nicely wrapped up inside your net asset value, which is the unit price that you pay to buy and sell a mutual fund scheme. Now, what happens is that, when mutual fund regulations came out in 1996, all those years ago, SEBI had fixed up, prescribed, the maximum limit of expenses that fund houses can charge. And the formula was devised in such a way that as your scheme corpus goes up, the expenses are supposed to come down. Now, what happened was that over a period of time, this formula was never revised, but the corpuses of schemes became large and larger, which means that, scheme corpuses became crossed 1,000 crore limit, they crossed 5,000 crore limit, 10,000, and even now today you have about close to 7 to 8 equity schemes only, which are more than 20,000 crore. There are 17 schemes which are more than 10,000 crore. So what happened was that because the formula never kept pace with the time, over a period of time, when the corpuses grew, when schemes became larger and when the sizes became more than 750 to 800 crore, the percentage of the TER, the total expense ratio as a percentage of your corpus, didn't come down. It sort of stayed at that same level. So which is why SEBI felt the need to revise the formula to account for schemes which are as large as even 20,000 crore or even 50,000 crore and more. So the lesser the expenses, the lesser the expenses that the fund houses charge you, the more money comes in your hand.
Okay, and what are the expenses related measures that SEBI has taken to make mutual funds more transparent?
So last year when SEBI came out with this rule to cut the expense ratios, it also said that all the expenses that fund houses incur, distribution fees and so on and so forth, everything has to be met from the scheme itself. Now, up to the point, up to 31st of March, what used to happen was that, the AMCs also used to incur additional distribution expenses, which they used to take it on their own books. Like for example, foreign holidays or reward programs that fund houses had for distributors, they used to take the costs in their own books. And SEBI felt that that's not really a very good practice, because whatever expenses that the AMC incurs on your funds have to be met from the schemes itself to avoid mis-selling or to avoid any kind of disproportionate commissions to be paid to distributors.
Well, that's good news for investors, but distributor commission will also go down now. Let's move our attention to debt funds. Why has SEBI turned its focus on below investment grade securities, and how will that impact investors?
So, Sakshi, what happened was that the focus on debt funds was increased a lot after the ILFS fiasco, which we have discussed in this show before. The ILFS fiasco, which unfolded in the months of August and September 2018. Now, what happens was that because debt markets are so illiquid, rating agencies are appointed by the AMFI, which is the Association of Mutual Funds, to give the valuation of each security that all the debt funds have invested in. Now, what happens is that based on these valuation that CRISIL and ICRA gives to the mutual funds, the mutual debt funds are supposed to value their securities, and that's how you get your NAV of your debt fund. Now, what happens is that these rating agencies that I said that they give out the values of the securities, they give out the values of only those securities that are above investment grade, but they do not give the values of securities that are below investment grade, is below the BBB rating. So now what SEBI said is that these rating agencies will also give you the valuation of securities which are rated BBB and below, so that there is uniformity in the way the NAVs are calculated.
And why did SEBI feel it is important for rating agencies to give valuations of debt securities that get downgraded to below investment grade?
What happened after the IL&FS crisis is that, different fund houses started to value these kind of bad securities, so-called bad securities, in a different way. So they used to mark down these securities. Some fund houses had marked down the securities by, say, 25%. Some other fund houses had done by 50%. So as a result of which, suppose if you are an investor in one fund which has marked down a particular security by, let's say, 50%, and I am an investor of another fund which has marked down the same security by 25%. So my NAV and your NAV will react to the same situation in a different way. So to remove this discrepancy, SEBI said that valuation committees should not be valuing these below rated securities. There should be rating agencies which should be valuing these securities, and all the fund houses will then have to fall in line with whatever values these rating agencies would give. So basically, in short, this gives uniformity to the way your NAVs are calculated.
And is that the only measure that SEBI has announced that would make the debt fund's NAV more realistic?
Sakshi, there is one more thing that SEBI announced recently as to how debt funds should calculate their NAVs. And it is like this, that, all the securities earlier, all the securities that used to mature up to 60 days time frame, these securities used to be amortized. And securities maturing over 60 days earlier, they used to be marked to market. Okay, now the 60-day threshold has come down to 30 days. So that means that all the securities that debt funds hold which mature up to 30 days will continue to be amortized, but over 30 days it has to be marked to market. So which means that your debt funds are set to get more realistic than before.
And Kayezad, does that mean that debt funds will get more volatile going ahead?
On paper, yes, but in practice, no, not much volatile, because most of the liquid funds already used to invest in papers which used to mature in about 20-25 days time or so. So even with this 60 days coming down to 30 days, it won't make much of a difference to your debt funds, and your debt funds aren't expected to be as volatile as they could have been. But, there is a lot of clamor in the industry. This one section of the industry which says that this 30-day threshold also should come down to 0 days. So as and when that happens, yes, then, debt funds will become quite realistic and will be prone to market volatility. But we are still some time away from the 30 days being coming down to 0 days.
Thanks a lot, Kayezad, for sharing with us all that insight. And with that, it's a wrap here. You can write into us at moneycontrolpf@nw18.com and send us your queries. Stay logged on to moneycontrol.com for more insight on personal finance. Thanks for watching.